some trails, it's nice to have company. Meeting strangers and learning why they're out in nature has always given me a sense of perspective and community I love. But this is not the trail for that. This is called the Solitude Loop for a reason, and I came out here to Wyoming's Bighorn Mountains to lose myself for a bit, forget who I am, remember who I was, and maybe make some progress in who I want to be. The trail started on the eastern side of the peaks, passing through forests of pine, before abruptly coming to a fork in the road. To the left was my path, and to the right was where I'd walk back 50 miles later. The approach into the mountains was long and quiet, and I was so deep in the forest that I couldn't see the looming mountains until I was right under them. Along the way, I got startled by a moose who snorted at me for disturbing its breakfast, but other than that, the trail provided exactly what it promised, solitude. More than that, it was dead quiet everywhere I walked. Climbing this first mountain pass felt like I was walking into a huge empty temple, and I was alone with the gods of the mountains, taking breaks next to the alpine lakes and watching clouds drift slowly through the sky. Wandering the alpine lakes on that first day was one of the highlights of my adventure, but as I dropped into the valley, I began to see the clouds deepen on the horizon, and I mentally prepared myself for a stormy night. By the time I found a campsite on the edge of a lake, the clouds were packing into the west, and I had walked more than 18 miles that day. Exhausted but excited, I staked out my shelter for high winds, but the impending storm had other plans that I never would have expected. It was shady most of the morning, and now the sun's finally coming out, and it's just beautiful out here. And it's so quiet. Unless you're by a river, which there is one over that way. Or unless you can hear the winds high in the peaks that way, which you can just barely hear now. Or maybe that's the river. Thank you. Walking into this valley was one of my favorite sections, since I could see the lake in the distance. Having a goal that you can see far away is one of the best parts of hiking in exposed terrain, since you can see your progress slowly advance, and it gives you a sense of scale for how big the mountains are, and how small you feel walking through them. When I'm really looking for solitude, that perspective helps quiet the world more than anything, since it reminds me that I share my world with so much, and that I'm just one part of it, slowly moving along a trail, searching for beautiful things. I woke to frost on the grass and a river crossing right next to my campsite that was absolutely freezing. That was the first of two unavoidable wet crossings, but fortunately, I made it through both of them without falling or getting more than my shins wet. The trail wound through low forests and foothills on the western flanks of the mountain range, eventually turning back east and heading towards higher elevation. By mid-morning, I reached my first major turning point of the adventure, taking an alternate and leaving the trail. The official Solitude Loop Trail continued north from here, and curved around a long expanse of the mountain range, staying at lower elevation and on well-maintained, clearly defined trails before eventually reaching a reservoir on the eastern side. My plan was to take a shortcut over the peaks and leave the Solitude Loop, heading towards the deeper mountains where I found the most gorgeous scenery of my adventure by a series of alpine lakes that would have been a perfect camping spot were it not barely noon. I continued higher, going off trail and climbing through the talus fields until I reached the top of the pass and the high point of my adventure. I was officially halfway done. It was windy, remote, and beautiful up there, but the true challenge was navigating a steep and precarious section of rock that dropped me into the valley below. From there, all I had to do was find the trail but I never found it. My maps were wrong, my GPS wasn't showing me reality. And I suddenly was as lost as I've ever been in the wilderness. I was prepared for something like this. Going off trail means you need to know your environment, and I knew the official trail met up at the reservoir to the east. I just needed to get there. The problem was that even though GPS said I was directly on a trail, I wasn't. The Trail of Lies, as I came to call it, still offered my best hope, since I guessed that my maps were simply offset a bit. So, I stuck to the GPS as close as I could and crawled through the underbrush at glacial speed, hopping over fallen trees, detouring around ravines, but aside from some animal trails that gave me hope but never lasted, I eventually admitted defeat and simply headed in a straight line towards the reservoir. As I crossed 16 miles for the day, I stopped my search and simply found a flat spot of ground to spend the night.
This is it. I'm leaving the official Solitude loop. I'm at this trail marking, and I'm taking this trail into some of the alpine lakes, and then this is the part where, like, once I get up to those lakes, leaving the official trail and scampering up over a pass. So it's the official point. Let's see how it goes. I just rounded the bend, and according to my map, I thought that I was going to have to climb that pass right there. And I was like, okay, that seems a bit much, but I think I could do that. And then I rounded this corner and I realized I'm climbing that one, which seems a lot nicer. So let's go. Here, the trail says that I'm climbing down over there. We'll see how that goes. That was a bit gnarly.
The most frustrating part of being lost was the cycle of hope and resignation. I found plenty of trails, usually thin animal ones, but I even found larger trails that ultimately just vanished into nothing beneath my feet. Additionally, I was so focused on the hunt for the trail that I neglected to drink enough, leaving my blood thick, my stomach tight, and my heart racing from the smallest inclines. I knew this feeling well from the collegiate loop in Colorado, so I maintained steady water, ate salty things, and took it slow. Thankfully, by the time I found a flat spot of ground, I was well enough to eat a full dinner, but I felt shaken by my sudden weakness earlier that evening, not to mention the looming worry of being without a trail 24 miles from the nearest exit. These are the moments where having some company helps, to share the worry and keep the anxiety from spiraling. But I came out here to find the edge of myself, and being this lost was definitely a new chapter for me. I don't always get to pick what will challenge me, but I can always choose how I respond. So I stuck to my camp routine, made a cup of tea, and fell into my audiobook as the light faded from the mountains. My thoughts calmed as I focused on what was real, and I felt that deep inner sense of myself breathe and stretch. Despite it all, I knew this was where I wanted to be. That morning I spent much as I had the evening previous, crawling through the trees, searching for a sign of trail. There was nothing but forest all around me, and I began to mentally prepare myself for many miles of this. My map showed another trail, the second trail of lies as I called it, and I decided to try my hopes at finding it. However, much like the previous attempt, no matter how closely I followed the GPS, the trail was nowhere in sight, and I soon abandoned that effort, again making straight for the reservoir. And then, I found it. Out of the blue, a well-worn, wide trail appeared in front of me, and I felt my spirit soar. To make up for my glacial pace in the underbrush, I powered through the morning, reaching the reservoir quickly and seeing the pass from the day previous in the distance. I got back onto the official Solitude Loop trail and felt the miles fly by as the morning progressed, and I truly left the mountains behind me. After 6 miles, I took a break by a roaring river to make coffee and have breakfast. But other than that, my mind was focused on one question. Could I hike fast enough to make it back to the trailhead by dusk? It would mean a 24-mile day, but I was feeling strong, so I went as fast as my body could handle, and before I knew it, I was back at a familiar junction where 2 days prior, I went left. Knowing the end was close but feeling the daylight falling faster and faster from the sky, I pushed myself the last few miles, and with aching legs and a manic grin, I found myself back at the trailhead, 60 miles from when I saw it last.
There is no trail, just following the forest, following the clear spots, until I link up with the actual trail.
See, here on the map, you can see GPS shows that we're right on the path. And this is what it looks like all around. I don't see a path. There's a lot of animal trails I follow for a few minutes or seconds and then they die out. And it's been this way for miles.
Can it be? Oh my God. It's the trail. Oh yeah. Okay. Feeling good, let's get moving.
Okay, see what I mean? Nowhere near on the trail, and yet this is definitely a trail. There's horse footprints and everything, so maps are wrong, but I found it anyway, and it's looking to be a beautiful, beautiful morning. Thank you.
a charming little bridge. Look at this. Just an itty bitty one. By a babbling brook.
These 24 miles were some of the most endless I'd ever felt on trail. A lot of it was on old logging roads, wide and rocky, covered in trees without many views, but I didn't get much video of that since it felt repetitive. I filled the hours with an impressive amount of audiobooks and enjoyed the wide open fields in between the forested trails. At around 2, I stopped for lunch as a caravan of horses trotted through the moor, laden with saddlebags. Despite my fast pace, I was wary of my fatigue the night previous, so I had a rare hot lunch of ramen to get a lot of calories, salt, and fluids into me for the 8 miles left that day. It was the best part of my afternoon. I thought a lot about getting lost the day previous, and what might have happened if I hadn't found the trail at all, or found it sooner. Managing anxiety and worry is a key skill to have when you're on your own for days on end. But just as I have learned from previous adventures and mistakes, I have also learned from previous times managing my anxiety poorly, and was able to recognize and leave my thoughts behind me on the trail. I escape out to places like these to connect with nature and myself. I don't want to spend my time here worrying. I want to spend it enjoying all the unexpected beauty, the small moments that make me laugh, and the feeling that every step I'm taking is my own. Except the steps down to the last mountain river to bring some water back for my older brother for making coffee.
Gotta get some water for Dustin.
It was a physically punishing day, full of emotional and physical challenge, but my spirits were soaring when I finally saw the trailhead through the trees. I could not believe the amount of beauty and solitude I felt in these 60 miles. So in the future, when I'm craving either, I'm sure I'll be back to these mountains for more.